Good morning, learners. Today, once again, we are going to continue with interest, the other theories related to determination of interest. Till now, we have seen that interest is a reward for wheat. Interest is a reward for sacrifice. Interest is given to capital because capital has got productivity. It's only because of productivity that interest is given to capital. It's because of weight which the people have to make by giving the money as investment to corporates and to governments that they wait. And because of this reason, they are paid interest. We found out that there are two groups of theories. One is the old theories. These old theories give us some philosophical idea about the interest, about determination of interest, about the reasons. About the reasons which give rise to interest. So we found that in the modern theories, the first theory is the classical theory of interest. And in this classical theory, we found that demand for capital and supply of capital, these two determine the interest. But then there are many weaknesses in this kind of a plan, this kind of a construct. Because the demand size is not complete, and similarly, the supply side is also not complete. And rate of interest and savings, they are indeterminate. So we come to another theory, that is liquidity preference theory of interest. This theory was propounded by J.M. Keynes, John Maynard Keynes. Keynes propounded this theory and said that people demand money because of their preference for liquidity. The fact that they want to keep some money liquid, that is how they make a demand for money. Now they will part away with this liquidity. I mean, if they give money, that means they part away with their liquidity, and they will do that only if some reward is given to them, and this reward is known as interest. So what Keynes says is that interest is the reward for parting away with liquidity for a specified period of time. Now, why do people need liquid cash? Keynes provides certain explanations. And he says people require liquid cash for certain reasons. First and the most important reason is the transaction motive. The second one is precautionary motive. And the third one is the speculative motive. So these are the three motives for which Keynes says that people want liquid cash. Now, let us take these one by one. Transaction motive. Transaction motive can be in the case of individuals as well as in the case of corporates and firms. If you take the case of individuals, then individuals get income at fixed intervals, say monthly, annually, weekly, fortnightly. This is the frequency of getting the income. But expenses are a daily phenomena. And the fact that expenses are a daily phenomena, people do need cash. So this is the transaction motive for which people require cash. Similarly, if we take the case of business, in a business, there are n number of transactions which take place in a day. And whereas earnings of the business are also a continuous process, but these earnings are decided after a certain period of time when all the payments have been made. So gross receipts cannot be termed as earnings. Naturally, therefore, firms need to keep some cash to meet their current obligations. If the firms cannot meet their current obligations, then in that case it will bring a good bad name to these firms. So they also want liquid cash for transaction motive. And then the third one, the second one, first is the transaction motive for individuals as well as for the corporates and firms. Second one, precautionary motive. Everybody wants to keep some liquid cash to ward off the emergencies, sometimes health emergency, sometimes any other emergency which may arise. So for these emergencies, people keep liquid cash. And the fact that they have this liquid cash, it helps them to meet this requirement during the times of emergencies. So these two motives, that is transaction motive and the precautionary motive, these motives are not dependent on interest. You give any amount of interest, but they need that much of cash for transaction motive, as well as they need certain amount for precautionary motive. So any amount of interest is not going to influence the size of money required, capital required for transaction motive, and size of capital required for precautionary motive. But yes, people do keep some part of their money for speculative motives. What is the speculative motive? By speculative motive, Keynes says, we mean that people keep some money in the expectation of rising interest rates. And when the interest rates rise, at that point of time, they invest this money so that they can maximize their earnings. And when the interest rate is low, they do not invest in invest in the market. So because the motive is speculative, they want to play on the difference in the rates of interest prevailing in the market. This is a speculative motive. So now Keynes says that adding up all these motives, that is transaction motive, precautionary motive, and speculative motive, will give us total demand for money in a country, in a society, over a period of time. Now, we need to know that transaction motive and precautionary motive do not depend on the rate of interest. Even if the rate of interest is high, this part of money will be retained. But a speculative motive depends on interest. Only when the rate of interest is high, this money will be released. This money will come into demand. So Keynes says we can put the first two, that is transaction motive and the precautionary motive, together and call these L1. And similarly, speculative motive can be referred to as L2. So total demand of money in a society at any period of time will be equal to L1 plus L2. Now when we say that this is the total demand for money, then we should know this thing, that this LP curve can be created now. It's one part, that is speculative motive, is influenced by the rate of interest. And the other part is not influenced by the rate of interest. So in its initial phase, it will be sloping downwards to right. But after a certain point, it will become flat and parallel to x-axis. The portion during which this LP line is parallel to x-axis has been referred to as the liquidity trap by Keynes. Because in this situation, people would definitely demand money for keeping in the form of liquid, for transaction motive as well as for precautionary motive. So the last part of this curve, initially the curve is sloping downwards to the right, and there comes a point when it becomes parallel to x-axis. This part has been referred to as liquidity trap by Keynes. Because here, people would like to keep their money with them. Ek break lete hain chota sa. Bathroom jayenge. Hello.
Yes.
So, this was the demand side. Demand side is represented by LP curve. Now we come to the supply side. Keynes says that supply of money constitutes coins, currency notes, and bank credit available in a country during a period of time. Now this is always fixed by a regulator, usually from the government. So the government regulator fixes as to how much of money will be in circulation at a point of time or over a period of time. That means this is always given. So the total coins, paper currency, bank credit, everything put together is given. Once it is given, it becomes a straight line in a diagram parallel to y-axis. So it's a straight line, and the quantum of capital available in a country at a point of time is fixed. It is not variable. It is fixed. So now if we put these two diagrams, two sides in one diagram, that is the demand side represented by LP curve, and similarly the supply side, which is the fixed quantity shown by a curve which is known as the supply line of capital. If we draw both these lines in one diagram, that is, first we will draw the LP line. LP line will be sloping downwards to right, having a negative slope. But then towards the end, it will become flat and it will be parallel to x-axis. And whereas the supply line, we may give it any name, say MQ. Supply line MQ will be a straight line parallel to y-axis. Now, wherever these two lines intersect, say point E, that point E will be the point of equilibrium. At this point, the rate of interest will be fixed. So, if you draw a perpendicular line on the y-axis from this point E and it touches there at point P, that means OP is the rate of interest. And at this OP interest, OQ quantity of money is demanded in the market. Now, this is an equilibrium. Now, what happens? Supposing the income of the people increases. So, if the income of the people increases, then LP line will also shift towards right. And a new LP line will be drawn. Now, this new LP line will intersect the original supply line of the money fixed by the government at some other point. And usually now what happens is that the same quantity of money fetches higher amount of interest, say OP1. Now at OP1 interest, the same quantity shall be demanded. There may be one other situation. And in this situation, supposing the supply of money is increased by the government, then the supply line will shift towards right. Initially, we had MQ supply line. Now, a new supply line towards the right, M1, Q1, shall be drawn. This supply line will also be having the same shape, that is parallel to y-axis, and it will intersect the original line at a different point, E2. And we will notice that at E2, more capital is available for less amount of interest, because supply of money has been increased by the government regulator. So this is how the LP theory or liquidity preference theory of Keynes talks about determination of interest. In a nutshell, let me put it again. Keynes says that money is demanded for three purposes. One, transaction motive. Second one is precautionary motive. And third one is speculative motive. The transaction motive and precautionary motive do not depend upon the rate of interest, whereas the speculative motive totally depends on the rate of interest. Therefore, the LP curve drawn with this information will become the demand line of interest. And this will be downward sloping, having a negative slope, but towards the end, it will flatten and become parallel to x-axis. Then supply line, Keynes says, is always fixed by the government regulator. And the fact that supply line is fixed, naturally, therefore, no changes can be introduced in it by the market or by anybody else. So wherever these two lines intersect, that is the point of determination of interest, and that is the equilibrium interest for the market at that particular point of time. Now let us take some criticism of this theory. It is a very important fact that capital is demanded for its productivity. But Keynes totally ignores productivity. Rather, he says that capital is demanded for certain motives, but he doesn't talk about productivity. This does not appear to be very logical, because ultimately, why would industry demand capital? Industry would demand capital so that it may produce certain goods and services for the people. So productivity of capital is a very important factor. Secondly, it takes into account the factors of demand side and supply side, but it does not take into account the real factors, that is savings and investment. Savings, whatever are there in a society at a particular point of time, and investment, whatever is there in a society at a particular point of time, he doesn't take it into account. In this theory, the third important thing is that in this theory, supply of money is beyond the control of market forces, because supply of money is fixed by the government. And since the supply of money is fixed by the government, market cannot determine, market cannot intervene in this process of determination of the rate of interest. It is again important that this theory holds good in the short run and not in the long run. The reason is that demand and supply both in this case are the short-term phenomena. And finally, one more important criticism against this theory given by Keynes is that LP2 cannot be known. LP2 means speculative motive, money for a speculative motive, cannot be known unless the rate of interest is known. And rate of interest cannot be decided unless LP2 is known. Therefore, the criticism which Keynes made of classical theory, the same criticism applies here also, because LP2 directly depends upon the rate of interest. So unless rate of interest is known, LP2 will not be known. And rate of interest can be known only when LP2 is known. So this is the second important modern theory of interest, known as liquidity preference theory of Keynes. ठीक है रोक दें यहीं पे, कितना हुआ। द थर्ड इम्पॉर्टेंट थियरी, मॉडर्न थियरी इज लोनेबल फंड्स थियरी ऑफ इंटरेस्ट। दिस लोनेबल फंड्स थियरी इज एन इम्प्रूवमेंट ओवर द क्लासिकल थियरी ऑफ इंटरेस्ट एंड देयरफॉर इकोनॉमिस्ट्स कॉल दिस थियरी एज नियो क्लासिकल थियरी ऑफ इंटरेस्ट। गुन्नार मेडल, ओहलिन एंड मेनी अदर्स कॉन्ट्रीब्यूटेड टू द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ दिस थियरी। This theory takes into account the monetary and non-monetary, both the factors, when they talk about the interest and capital. They use the word loanable funds. Loanable funds refers to so many other types of sources of funds also. Like classical theory believed that funds come from savings, but loanable funds theory gives the option that funds may come from bank credit, funds may come from disholding of past savings. So there is a difference between the two terms. Term one, savings in the classical theory, and the term loanable fund under this loanable funds theory are different. So this is rather a wider term. Now, demand for loanable funds. Demand for loanable funds is made by producers, including traders, consumers, and government. Now, even for holding, demand for money is made. Holding may be done by individuals for their requirements. They need to hold money. It may be done by the business to hold money for some future emergencies, future requirements, and even the government holds some amount of money. So that idea of Keynes is present here in a different manner. So producers demand capital, producers demand funds, and they demand these funds for holding purposes, for production purposes. Now, this demand by the producers is always equal to the marginal productivity of capital. Whatever is the marginal productivity of capital, the same amount is demanded by the people. And in all the cases, what we find is the inverse relationship between interest and loanable funds. So adding up all these requirements, that is requirement by producers, requirements by consumers, requirements by government, you add up all these requirements and what you get to know is the total demand for capital. But yes, it will have an inverse relationship with interest. Loanable funds will increase when more interest is given. Loanable funds will decrease when less interest is given. So this is a line which has got a negative slope, comes downwards sloping from the top point of y-axis towards the x-axis. And now let us take the supply. Supply of capital. Where does it come from? Supply comes from savings. Who makes these savings? These savings are made by individuals. These savings are made by households. These savings are made by firms and corporates. And even the government sometimes makes these savings. So these are the sources of savings. Then there is yet another important source of supply of capital is bank credit. Banks create credit, and this credit is also a very important source of supply of capital. Then disholding of past savings, because classical theory never considered this factor. Classical theory never considered bank credit. So these are the additions in this new theory, that is loanable funds theory. And here we find that disholding of past funds, bank credit is taken into account while deciding the supply. One more important thing which has been considered by this new classical theory, And that is, firms usually maintain a fund of depreciation. This fund is maintained to replace the asset after a certain period of time. But when the rates of interest in the market are higher, then firms do not keep that money in the depreciation fund. Rather, they put this money in the market. So one can say that non-retention of the depreciation fund is also a source of supply of funds. So this is how loanable funds are created. Now, what kind of relationship do these loanable funds have with the interest? Naturally, it is a direct relationship. And when we say direct relationship, it means as the rate of interest goes up, more and more loanable funds are supplied. So this becomes the supply line. Now, in a diagram, when we put the demand line, negatively sloped demand line, and positively sloped supply line, on y-axis we show the rate of interest, and on the x-axis we show the quantity of loanable funds, then we get to know that there is a point of intersection of these two curves. We may call it E. And from this E, a perpendicular line can be drawn on the y-axis, and similarly a perpendicular line can be drawn on the x-axis. And now we get to know that at OP interest, OQ capital is demanded, or OQ loanable funds are demanded. This is equilibrium. Now, supposing for certain reasons this equilibrium is disturbed, say the rate is fixed a little upwards, say E1, above the equilibrium point. Now what will happen? Demand will be less and supply will be more. So when demand is less and supply is more, that means rate of interest will fall down and it will have the tendency of coming back to equilibrium point E. Similarly, let us take another extreme wherein somehow the rate of interest is fixed below the equilibrium point. And below equilibrium point, what do we find? That supply is less and demand is more. So when supply is less and demand is more, that means rates will rise. And eventually, the rates of interest will get decided, will get fixed up, and will be in equilibrium at point E only. That is the point of intersection of the demand curve and the supply curve. And this has to be remembered very clearly, that this denotes the marginal productivity of capital. The marginal interest is equal to the marginal productivity of capital. Whatever interest, that is OP is the amount of interest. Now this interest is equal to the marginal productivity of capital. This is the loanable funds theory. There are many weaknesses in this theory also. Like, this theory does not take into account the levels of changes in income. It believes that supply of capital depends upon the savings. But the truth is, supply of capital depends upon the level of income in a society at any particular point of time. Savings do not depend on interest. Rather, savings depend on the level of income. This is a criticism which J.M. Keynes made of this theory. Then this theory propounds that people will invest more when the rate of interest is higher. But sometimes it is not true. If the rate of interest is high, people do not come out to invest more. And as a result, what happens that when the rate is low, then investment is more. And when the rate is high, not much investment is made. And once again, we find the same trap over here also. That is, we need to know the savings, to know the rate of interest, and we should know the rate of interest so that we may decide about the savings. That indeterminate situation exists with this loanable funds theory of interest also. So what we have noted is that these three important theories, classical theory, liquidity preference theory, and loanable funds theory, all these theories give very important inputs to us. But none of the theory can be considered to be a complete theory or a proper theory of interest. And therefore, we come to the last theory, that is the modern theory of interest. This modern theory takes into account all these factors which are relevant for the purpose. And whatever learning has been made till now by us, by the study of all these aspects, like in the classical theory, it is marginal productivity. In the classical theory, there is savings and investment. This is one factor which we get from there. Then Keynes talks about liquidity preference. So liquidity preference is taken from Keynes. And in the loanable funds theory, we get to know about the supply of capital. That is, the supply can be made by way of bank credits, by way of disholding of past savings, and the supply can also be made by way of non-retention of depreciation fund. So we will continue with this in the next lecture. Thank you very much.